Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Never get a real job. How to dump your boss, build a business, and not go broke. By Scott Gerber. This book is dedicated to the death of the real job. Die, you miserable bastard. Forward. I started my first business when I was 16 years old. Being an entrepreneur has completely changed my life for the better. Simply put, it is the single best professional decision I've ever made. Over years of hard work, I've written a best-selling book, The Student Success Manifesto, spoken to tens of thousands of fellow Generation Yers, built a successful business that promotes entrepreneurship on college campuses, called the Extreme Entrepreneurship Tour, and been featured in national media that I only dreamed of. However, what many people don't know is that I had over $40,000 in credit card debt at my lowest point, and had to constantly hear my mom ask me when I was going to get a real job. When I was first getting started, none of my friends had any idea what entrepreneurship was. I can remember the stress of pursuing a vision that I felt I saw clearly, but that no one else could see. I questioned myself constantly about whether or not I was doing the right things. But I kept on going, and in the end it all paid off. Not because of luck, but because I actually learned how to run a business. I only wish that Never Get a Real Job had been written when I was getting started, so I could have learned from Scott's mistakes instead of my own. Today's 20-something-year-olds are experiencing the reality of this book even as I write this foreword. After nearly 2 decades of schooling, with lots of student debt, in preparation for the real world, a large percentage of today's young people are moving back in with their parents, taking low-paying jobs that they could have done in grade school, or going on to further education in hopes that there might be a job waiting for them once they graduate. Good luck. The reality is that we're all experiencing more of a sign of the times to come than of a passing recession. In tomorrow's world, being an entrepreneur will be a requirement for success. If Generation Y adopts this mindset, I believe it will create a new level of prosperity that we have never seen. However, if it doesn't, I fear that Generation Y will become the lost generation. Never Get a Real Job is a timely book that needed to be written, and Scott Gerber is the perfect person to write it. Scott is part of his audience, and he's successfully done what he's asking his readers to do. He has an entertaining style, which makes the book a page-turner. The old path of going to the right school, getting good grades, and going right into your dream job is broken, which is why this book should be required reading for every college student and 20-somethings, because it gives people a new, clear path and shows them how to go from where they are to achieving their personal and career goals. Scott provides a solution that he himself recently navigated through. Instead of the typical narrative from other business books, "I'm super successful, and 20 years ago, when I was in your position, here's what I did." Scott's narrative is more authentic, relatable, and therefore easier and more effective to apply. He is still in his 20s, and very recently in the same exact position as his readers. He admits that he doesn't yet own a Ferrari, yet his success is extremely impressive and inspiring nonetheless. Never Get a Real Job is also very realistic, pulls no punches, and is perfect for the times we're in. It doesn't provide the rosy perspective of, "If you become an entrepreneur, money will take care of itself and you'll be able to live happily ever after." Instead, it warns you about the misconceptions of entrepreneurship and provides a systematic 3-stage approach to minimize your risk and get money into your pocket as soon as possible. In the end, this book is a great wake-up call for both parents and young people. Scott warns parents that the go-to-school, get-good-grades, and get-a-good-job mantra is broken. At the same time, he doesn't simply let young people off the hook. He shares that to be successful, will require a ton of hard work over time, learning new skills, and constantly going outside your comfort zone. I guarantee that if you follow Scott's advice, your success will not be a question of if, it will be a question of when. This book and Scott's highly trafficked youth entrepreneurship columns are just the start of the Never Get a Real Job movement, and I'm honored that my organization is a part of it. Michael Simmons, founder of the Extreme Entrepreneurship Tour. Introduction. Scott, when are you going to get a real job? With those words, my mother had decided to bring up the question for what seemed like the millionth time. A question that had become the dreaded bane of my existence conversation starter. One that felt like root canal surgery without the Novocaine every time I heard it. Even though I had fought hard to win this discussion countless times before, she simply wouldn't let the topic die. Being 1 year out of an expensive university without a real job to show for it gave my steady paycheck, benefits-loving schoolteacher mother heart palpitations. Granted, I wasn't making much money at the time, but I certainly wasn't living on the streets begging for change either. My startup company was generating a modest income, comparable to most entry-level positions, and was enabling me to feed myself, pay my rent, and socialize like any other normal 20-something-year-old. And although I was busting my ass, hustling my way into pitch meetings with Fortune 500 companies, every time I heard my name in the same sentence with the phrase "real job," which according to my mother meant one with a specific title in which I worked for someone else, well, it was almost as if none of my hard work mattered. Fear of deviation from the straight arrow path drove my mother to constantly ask this question of me. And the only way she could calm her fears was to try to scare the hell out of me and to point out why my life choices were unequivocally flawed. One day you're going to have a family. How are you going to support them? You'll want a nice house. You'll have to pay a mortgage, she cautioned frequently. The tone of this discussion changed regularly, usually shifting between loud and louder. However, the main points were always consistent. What are you doing with your life? Why did I send you to college? How do you plan to make a living? Frustrated and standing my ground, we'd begin the big debate. I know what I'm doing, I would reply. Just because I don't work 9 to 5 like you doesn't mean I'm not making a living. She'd respond with an apples to oranges comparison. Your friends are all moving forward in their lives. They all have good jobs and are building their careers. I don't understand why you can't do the same. I'd throw in some sharp-tongued, sarcastic comment, criticizing her values. You taught me to be a leader, not a follower, didn't you? Or was that only meant to be applied to every other aspect of my life? My mother would inevitably try to end the debate with an existential-sounding proverb of her own design, meant to illuminate my foolish train of thought. You don't want to wake up one day and see that life has passed you by, do you? But it never ended there. This argument was a test of wills. It could go on for 5 minutes or 5 hours. But after all of the pointless back-and-forth banter and skyrocketing blood pressure, the exchange only resulted in a stalemate and fueled similar debates later. There is a good reason that becoming an entrepreneur feels so natural to so many of us, whether they realize it or not, and as I pointed out to my mother during these trying discussions, our parents and our teachers encouraged us to be that way. Years of lauding and backpatting ingrained in us the notion that we could conquer the world. Ironically, what our mentors neglected to teach us was how to actually live that lifestyle. And the thought of us not getting a job terrifies them. Why? Because our parents learned from our grandparents that a job, preferably a safe one with benefits and a pension, was necessary for survival. But while our parents and teachers may have felt comforted by this security, Rarely was it what they actually wanted from their careers. Naturally, they wanted us to pursue our dreams at all costs, sometimes even to the point of risking poverty to put us through college. The problem is that they didn't know truly how to help us get there. And if they didn't know how to survive as entrepreneurs themselves, then how could they teach us to avoid getting a real job? They couldn't, so we didn't learn. And our education system doesn't fill in that gap. In fact, it's meant to teach us to be employees. So when we graduate, we're made to believe that our choices are to get a real job or hit the highway. Rather than chalk my mother's encouragement up as another bedtime story, I chose the highway and set out to learn the practical skills and tricks necessary to become what she dreamed I would be. These are the lessons I will now teach you. Who needs the 9-to-5? The mere thought of living the conventional 9-to-5 life plan, creating wealth for the man instead of for myself, made me want to reach simultaneously for a bottle of Xanax and vodka. Cubicle farms, incompetent bosses, strict dress codes, and inane corporate acronyms crammed into a potentially 50 to 60 hour work week that was out of my control, in exchange for a paycheck that barely covered expenses. It all sounded like torture. And it wasn't for me. So I simply made up my mind that I was never going to get a real job. I'd find a way to make it on my own and create a life of my own design. I just needed to figure out how the hell to do that. I took a trip to the local bookstore during my sophomore year of college to find some material written by entrepreneurial peers who could offer me practical insights. After hours upon hours of reading book jackets and tables of contents, the sheer volume of redundant business plan books and mundane startup how-to guides overwhelmed me. There were countless books promising quick fixes and instant millions. There were dense dissertations packed with MBA jargon from hoity-toity academic theorists, more than a fair share of war story autobiographies from famous rock star entrepreneurs, and boatloads of overly glamorized soft covers that made entrepreneurship sound as if readers were guaranteed success if they just set their minds to it. There wasn't, however, a single practical book written by a 20-something-year-old with whom I could identify. Not one book in the entire store by a down-to-earth, Generation Y business owner who had turned the nothing they started with into something they wanted. I didn't want to learn to incorporate a business or write a business plan. This was hardly insider information and could be found almost anywhere online anyway. I wanted solid, real-life advice from a peer who understood where I was and what I needed to do to build a business, not just a theoretical plan on paper. With the hope that my assumptions were wrong and the feeling that I had to buy something to get myself on track, I purchased a few titles. Sadly, I wasn't wrong, and I ended up $75.65 poorer as a result. Most of the books I bought were repetitive and wholly unrealistic for aspiring entrepreneurs. I began to wonder if any of these so-called business experts had ever even met a college student, recent grad, or young person looking to start his or her own business before. Ask friends and family for startup capital? The author might as well have said, "Good luck, but if daddy doesn't have deep pockets, don't even bother. Get a real job, punk." Apply for bank loans and credit lines to gain access to operating capital? Sure, because so many of us have outstanding credit and have already paid off all of our debts and student loans. Yeah, right. I might not have had a pot to piss in, but I sure as hell wasn't about to quit because some blowhard authors had penned one-size-fits-all approaches to starting a business in exchange for an advance check from a publisher and an expert credential to headline their blogs. No matter. Nothing was going to stop me from fulfilling the promise I had made to myself, not even being clueless about how to start a business. With barely a dollar to my name and no resources to guide me, I did what I thought any half-cocked, passionate, ambitious, impulse-driven know-it-all would do. I got started and figured it out for myself. Crazy? Perhaps. But in the end, my decision and subsequent hard work paid off tenfold. Sure, there were nights I went hungry and days I nearly starved. But as the months and years passed, I found ways to feed myself quite well, all without a suitable guidebook. Fortunately, you won't have to face the same situation. It's a problem I've now remedied for you with Never Get a Real Job. I know you. Let me be clear. I don't have millions of dollars in the bank, six-figure sports cars, or gold-plated yachts. I'm not the product of a wealthy family or a storied entrepreneurial heritage, nor am I the outcome of an accredited business school. In fact, I graduated from a film school where I never attended a single business or mathematics class. So why should you listen to what I have to say? After all, who am I to tell you how to build a successful business? Because I know what it's like to have to move back in with your parents and how depressing it is to have shrinking bank accounts and mounting debts. I know what's in store for you. I know what you think is going to happen versus what will actually happen. I understand you because I am you. I was where you are right now. Confused, eager, antsy, disappointed, scared, unfulfilled, and ready for something more. And not 30 years ago either. More importantly, my journey and its results are proof that anyone has the ability to survive, thrive, and make the seemingly impossible happen, all without ever needing to get a real job. Since I became an entrepreneur, I've built several successful companies and others that didn't last more than 3 months. I've worked alongside both smart partners and idiots. I've made a lot of money, but I've failed more times than I've succeeded. Through it all, I've always been my own boss. I've never worked for the man. And I've never gone bankrupt. Both my successes and failures have prompted me to develop new ways of thinking about business. I've created business planning, bootstrapping, and sales and marketing methodologies that have enabled me to build a steady and sustainable lifestyle, supported by a healthy six-figure income. I've shared my strategies with tens of thousands of aspiring entrepreneurs through my syndicated Entrepreneur column, and will now share them with you in this book. What you can expect to get from this book. Let's get a few things straight at the outset. I don't have any magic formulas for raising capital or get-rich-quick schemes. If you're looking for cutesy gimmicks and paperwork exercises, then look elsewhere. If you're shopping for a miracle cure or infomercial-style promises that will get you from zero to hero in a week, allow me to offer you some free advice. Your ideals are totally unrealistic, and unless you change your mindset, you're hopeless. You can't lose 50 pounds in 1 week by sitting stationary in a chair with a machine strapped around your gut, and you can't build a successful, lucrative, and sustainable business overnight. Unlike many other startup guidebooks that offer you a few tips that might help you make a quick buck, the multifaceted approach to entrepreneurship I present to you here includes a full attack on your lifestyle. It presents logic that will challenge you mentally and emotionally. It asks you to make many tough choices, the outcomes of which will affect every facet of your life. All of this is done for a single purpose: to train you to generate immediate income to support yourself and build a business, whether you have a budget or not a single dollar to your name. This book helps you to become a person who sees no limits, doesn't believe in boundaries, and won't take no for an answer. It helps you become a person who balks at the 9-to-5 system that conditions us to be dependent, and someone who stays the course even when independence is hard or damn near impossible. This book helps you become a person unafraid to fail, even when conventional wisdom would say to play it safe. Above all, it will teach you that entrepreneurship isn't just about what you know, what you do well, or even who you know, but rather whether you can execute effectively and make things happen. Some people get it. Most people don't. This book teaches you how to get it. All aboard the Death to the Real Job Express. Whether you're wasting away in a cubicle wanting to climb the tallest clock tower, feverishly mailing out resumes, praying you'll get a real job to help you start paying down college loans, or a student who's terrified to graduate to the real world to a position as an underemployed grunt, here is my challenge to you. Give yourself the opportunity to take control of your own destiny, walk on your own 2 feet, and fail or succeed on your own terms. Accept my challenge? Good. Welcome aboard the Death to the Real Job Express, a one-way ticket to the new and self-sufficient you. I'll be your conductor. The coddling is over. I'm not going to handle you with kid gloves or sugarcoat anything. If that's the sort of education you're looking for, apply to an MBA program. I didn't write this book to tell you how special you are, because to be quite honest, you're not. You're not a delicate flower or a ray of sunshine. I don't care about your college degree, your pedigree, or how much you have in the bank. And guess what? Neither does the rest of the world. I'm here to tell it like it really is. Not like you wish it was or thought it was going to be, and certainly not like your parents, professors, and MTV told you it would be. I plan to treat you and your startup the same way the real world will, and that is to say, not favorably. Now, forget everything you thought you knew to be true. Leave your preconceived notions about the real job at the door, and tune out your parents, professors, and the pundits. It isn't going to be easy, but together, we're going to deconstruct you, build a solid foundation, and help you to rebuild your ideal entrepreneurial self that will be prepared to avoid the dreaded 9-to-5 lifestyle. Now, hop on board. Next stop, learning to become the self-employed business owner you were meant to be. Part 1. The Breakdown. Chapter 1. Everyone poops. Yours isn't special. When our parents came of age in the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s, working for the man was the only game in town. Our grandparents, mostly members of the Great Depression generations, for whom jobs were considered luxuries, reinforced the ideas that getting a job and working hard were essential to building a sustainable living. Thus, the mantra was born, work hard, get good grades, go to college, and get a job. Before we were even born, our parents fantasized about what we would be when we grew up. They wanted things to be better for us, but in a much different way than their parents had planned for them. There was a generational divide here. To our grandparents, getting a job was a matter of survival, but our parents wanted more than survival for us. They wanted us to find our dream job and thrive. We couldn't just get any job. They had much bigger ideas for us. They wanted us to find a cure for cancer, write the next great American novel, or become president of the United States. The possibilities seemed endless. Their expectations ran wild and knew no bounds. Before the doctor even cut our umbilical cords, we were already winners who were destined to surpass their wildest dreams, even though they had no idea what that meant or how we could even begin to make their dreams a reality. And then the big day arrived. You might have entered the world as an 8-pound ton of fun with a face that scared off the family dog, but it didn't matter. The moment you left the womb, you were a special, perfect, one-in-a-million diamond in the rough who would one day perform open-heart surgery blindfolded while climbing Everest. From that day forward, the world revolved around your every action, You giggled, and your parents thought it was brilliant. You rolled over, and you were amazing. When you walked, they told everyone who would listen how incredible you were. You mumbled some incoherent iteration of mom or dad that sounded more like bus stop. And it was life-changing. Relatives would even line up to clean your diaper just to get a whiff of your majestic, rosy-fragranced poop. And the adoration didn't end at infancy. It was time to call the NBA when you almost hit that foul shot during your fourth-grade basketball scrimmage. Graduating from middle school was a crowning achievement, and when you made your singing debut in the high school musical's background ensemble, your parents swore that you were on your way to Broadway. For years, your parents, teachers, and MTV blew smoke up your ass at every turn. You were showered with undeserved accolades, encouraged to aspire to unrealistic goals, and praised for exaggerated achievements. You were the unwitting victim of a coddling culture fated to screw up your perception of reality. No matter how pathetic the award or how asinine the proverb, you bought into it all, hook, line, and sinker. You were so busy riding the "everyone is a winner" bandwagon that you failed to realize that you were being rewarded for mediocrity, or worse, out of pity. Your parents put you on a teetering pedestal, instead of providing you a strong and realistic foundation for the rest of your life. Encouraging you to aim high is one thing, but by keeping you from feeling the sting of failure and not allowing you space to fend for yourself independently, your parents, teachers, and coaches unknowingly set you up to be a weak, ineffectual person, unprepared for adulthood. College, the drunken road to Easy Street. From your time in the cradle up to high school graduation, you were likely force-fed everything from Sesame Street to SAT prep courses. You were pushed to read faster, be smarter, and raise your GPA in the hopes that one day you'd be accepted into a top-rated college, and that would set you up for life. But rather than instilling the desire to pursue a real job, college taught you to hate them. Most professors were open-minded thought leaders who encouraged discussion. Unlike the mandated dress codes in primary and secondary schools, college promoted a sense of individuality and expression. No one dictated where or how you worked, as long as you got the work done. Cheating, or achieving grades so low that teachers began to question whether you had a pulse, were two of very few reasons you might be expelled, which were better odds than hoping for job security. When you did manage to find the time to pay attention or even make it to class, you probably realized that your classes weren't offering you the critical skills necessary for the real world. College courses seemed to train you for the same mythical dream job your parents desired for you. There were no lectures on corporate hierarchy, filing documents, or answering phones. When you weren't wasting time taking classes that were about as useful as a screen door in a submarine, you were receiving a high-level education that taught you how to do your eventual employer's job, not the remedial tasks of his entry-level assistant. Simply put, you were told what to think, not how to think. Instead of breaking free from the system and taking control of your own life, you took the easy road. You decided to allow your perception of reality to remain warped, because you knew you had a reward just waiting to be cashed in. Your BS in BS was your meal ticket to superior job placement and untold riches. Or so you thought. Dude, where's my dream job? The years passed by so fast that before you knew it, you were finishing up your senior year of college. In a few short months, you'd be pantsless, wearing a cap and gown, accepting a six-figure sheet of oak tag, and finding yourself one step closer to retirement by 30. All of the B-minus term papers and drunken debauchery was finally going to pay off. It was time to get paid. You typed up your resume in 12-point Times New Roman with your name centered at the top in bold caps. You grossly exaggerated your internship experience and gave yourself the title of VP of Operations, Marketing, and Accounting. You printed the document on 110-pound scented yellow stationery and, along with your formulaic cover letter, proudly handed the completed package to your career development counselor for her seal of approval. I'm sure there was a tear in his or her eye. You then proceeded to send resumes to all of the best employers you could find on the web. The excitement was palpable. It was time to accept your dream job. A few weeks went by and you didn't hear anything, but you didn't let that scare you. You had an accredited degree. But still, where was the harm in hedging your bets? So you sent out 10 more resumes. A few more weeks passed. No responses. No problem, though, right? It was only a matter of time before someone contacted you to schedule an interview. After all, you followed your life plan to the decimal. You got good grades, were accepted into college. Now the next step was to get the job of your dreams, right? But just to be sure, you sent out a few more resumes. Not too many, just 75 or so. You know, to be on the safe side. There's a good possibility that if you graduated several years ago, you applied for a bunch of corporate gigs and still haven't heard back from any employers. You're not alone. Juan Somavia, the Director General of the UN International Labor Organization, has recently announced that global youth unemployment has hit its highest levels ever, with 81 million young people unemployed worldwide. According to a 2009 National Association of Colleges and Employers study, 80% of college graduates who were looking for jobs couldn't find one. The Economic Policy Institute recently announced that the class of 2010 faces the worst job market in a generation, with the Bureau of Labor Statistics putting unemployment among 19 to 24-year-olds over 15%. Even more disturbing is the recent study by the Pew Research Center, indicating that nearly 40% of all 18 to 29-year-olds have either been unemployed or underemployed at some point since December 2007. If you did hear from a potential employer, there's a fairly good chance you were denied a position because you were either underqualified for the jobs you wanted or overqualified for the jobs you applied for just to make ends meet. It didn't matter if you had a degree in electrical engineering. You'd be lucky to get an executive assistant gig at a corporate event planning company, if you got a job at all. But there is a silver lining. You're now a card-carrying member of the Boomerang Club, the first generation in history to attend college only to move back in with dear old mom and dad afterward because you're broke, unemployed, and in debt up to your eyeballs. Hooray for living the dream! I'm sure this is exactly how you envisioned your post-collegiate life. Welcome to your real job, Mr. Janitor. Maybe you were fortunate and did manage to land a job after college. However, chances are that whatever you're currently doing was not your first choice. It's probably not even your 10th or 20th choice. Heck, it's probably not even your 100th choice. Instead of being hired as the vice president of fashion design at Ralph Lauren, you most likely accepted a receptionist gig at Joey Fatayat's mortuary where the motto, "You kill 'em, we chill 'em," is proudly displayed on a neon sign in the parking lot. I'm sure they have a wonderful health insurance plan. And if by some miracle you were lucky enough to get a job in your chosen field, then you're most likely grinding it out as an underappreciated, underpaid, underemployed, bottom-of-the-food-chain receptionist barista gopher who often gets mistaken for the company intern. What happened to the dream job that was dangled in front of you like a carrot on a stick for your entire life? You departed college with the notion that you were regularly going to make life and death decisions and close billion-dollar deals over dinner meetings. So how is it exactly that you ended up sitting in a cubicle typing up your supervisor's meeting agenda, staring at a slow-ticking wall clock and wondering where it all went wrong? Where was your standing ovation for handing in your work early? Or the certificate for being on time every morning? How about the corner office with a view or the important responsibilities? Where is your A for effort? Claustrophobic cubicles, stale coffee, monotone dress codes, idiot bosses, mind-numbing water cooler debates, migraine-inducing birthday celebrations, infantile office politics, futile reports, repetitive phone-answering protocols. The only thing stopping you from running down the highway screaming like a madman is the thought of being forced to attend the Human Resource Department's new Multicultural Anger Management Seminar. Truth be told, whether your collar is blue or white, your real job is probably everything you never wanted it to be. And you're not alone. More people than ever are less than pleased with their current positions. In fact, according to a recent study conducted by the Conference Board, 45% of Americans hate their jobs. And perhaps more shocking, 73% of Americans under the age of 25 hate their jobs. If that many people are so completely miserable doing what they do on a daily basis, well, doesn't that tell you something about how broken the system is? Despite the encouragement you received, and still receive, to get one, real jobs present a problem for the following reasons. 1. Real jobs offer you a false sense of security. You've been conditioned to believe that a real job will offer you safety and security. However, the truth is that job security no longer exists, and it hasn't for a long time. Consider the numerous corporations that went bankrupt in the 2000s, where the decisions of the few greatly impacted the livelihoods of the many. Enron, Lehman Brothers, Circuit City, Linens and Things, General Motors, and so on. The list is frustratingly endless. Forget about gold watches and retirement lunches. In many cases, loyal employees didn't even receive severance or a shred of their decimated retirement savings. And let's not forget about the recession that has forced companies to lay off millions of employees, nearly 1 in 10 in some instances, just to maintain viability, and has caused the unemployment rate to escalate to levels that haven't been seen since the Great Depression. Detractors may argue that employees benefit from more security than entrepreneurs do. Yet, although entrepreneurs understand the risks they're taking in terms of their financial security, they still maintain total control over its direction. People with real jobs have very little, if any, say over financial and job security. The list of factors that can send you packing will only grow as employers continue to perfect their better, faster, cheaper philosophy to keep stockholders happy or increase top-level executive pay. There is only one thing that will undoubtedly become more and more commonplace. Pink slips. 2. Real jobs render you powerless. Clueless management, moronic colleges, tedious reports, unrealistic deadlines. What do all of these things have in common? It's simple. No one wants or cares about your opinion on any of them. Your job is to keep your head down and get whatever needs handling done, no questions asked. Don't kid yourself. In most instances, you're not a decision maker unless you are the decision maker. And chances are you're scared of whoever this truly is. In fact, according to a research poll conducted by workplace expert and Business Week columnist Lynn Taylor, the average U.S. employee spends more than 19 hours each week worrying about what their boss will do or say. That hardly seems productive to the corporate bottom line. Unlike entrepreneurs who succeed or fail based on their own decisions, Employees with real jobs must play the roles of obedient cogs in the machine, tasked with performing X function, Y amounts of times, to get Z result, for the sole benefit of the mothership. Deviation from the carefully designed corporate agenda dictated from above could result in unforeseen losses and, consequently, the termination of employment. After all, such actions prohibit you from improving the wealth of others, and that cannot be tolerated. Mind you, even if you abide by the corporate agenda and there are losses, it still doesn't mean you're guaranteed any sort of safety or severance. Say goodbye to freedom, and say hello to life as a corporate wage slave. 3. Real jobs overwork and underpay you. A recent study conducted by the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health found that the average U.S. employee works 2 months longer than an employee from 1969 for nearly the same salary after inflation adjustments. So, not only are many people overworked, they're also paid less for working more. What does this mean to you in dollars and cents? Maybe $35,100 annually, the average salary for 25 to 34-year-olds in the United States, according to the July 2010 Business Week article, Retirement, Gen Y's Empty Piggy Bank, a dollar amount that has come to be after falling 19% over the last 30 years after adjusting for inflation. For many entry-level employees, the workday doesn't end at 5 p.m., and it often includes portions of weekends. So we'll suppose that between putting out your boss's fires at 10 p.m. on Fridays and composing reports during football game viewing on Sundays, that your actual work week is 50 hours long. Breaking down your annual salary, your actual wage is a little more than $13.50 per hour. Oops, I forgot. According to the Department of Labor's overtime rules, you might not even be eligible for overtime. Silly me. And let's not forget about deductions to your paycheck for taxes and Social Security. So we'll make that more like $10 per hour. After you subtract for your clothing, travel expenses, college debts, and any costs associated with your company benefits package, well, you're lucky if you can afford a night out at the movies. On the bright side, you do get paid vacation days. Unfortunately, the average U.S. employee only gets around 13 vacation days, well below that of his counterparts in most other industrialized nations. Italy's average is 42, France's is 37, and Canada's is 26. And, according to the May 2009 CNN.com article, Layoff Worries Keep Many From Taking Vacations, 34% of Americans don't even use all of their vacation time because they're too afraid of losing their jobs. And although you might be eligible for a raise in a year or so, that's only likely to happen if the corporate bigwigs haven't taken all the profits to buy new vacation homes. Job-happy stalwarts may claim that being an entrepreneur doesn't guarantee you'll make more money than a salaried employee or work less hours, and they'd be right. However, unlike real job employees who are stuck in predetermined pay grades and boss-dictated work schedules, entrepreneurs benefit directly from every minute they spend on their business and have the ability to earn as much money as their efforts can produce. As companies continue to streamline their processes and globalization continues sending jobs overseas to cheaper labor markets, employees will find it increasingly more difficult to land a job that's willing to tolerate a more lenient work-life balance or pay them what they truly deserve for a full 40-hour work week. 4. Real jobs don't reward you for excellence. Not only are your wages pathetic, they are also a minuscule fraction of the marked-up prices that your company is charging its clients. Customers may be paying 10 times more than what you're earning, but other than the possibility of a small bonus, do you know what your upside is? Bupkis, nothing, zero, zilch, zip. Well, except, maybe, a health benefits package. Although, according to a Pew Research study, Gen Y is the least likely generation to receive health benefits, with nearly 40% uncovered by any sort of health plan whatsoever. No, the majority of the revenue that you generate goes toward overhead costs and lining the pockets of the senior executives. Did you have any idea that you were such a thoughtful and generous employee? In the end, your work week translates into nothing more than a paycheck and the honor of begging your incorrigible, take-all-of-the-credit boss for an insignificant promotion that may or may not include a measly raise. Sure, you might get an increase in wages or a bonus. However, it's a mere fraction of the upside you've produced. Equity? Partner status? In most companies, those are simply hilarious jokes to tell your fellow disgruntled employees around the water cooler. Your company expects you to give everything you have and more without offering you real incentives for the harder work. And even if a company does offer some sort of stock option, accepting it merely renders you that much more dependent on the only hand that feeds you, by putting more of your eggs into a single basket that you're neither holding nor have any real say in. I'm glad you trust your CEO with your financial future. I wonder if he feels the same way about you. And finally, 5. Real jobs slowly kill your entrepreneurial ambitions. Real jobs have one mission: to ensure that you keep creating value for employers under the guise of safety, security, and career advancement. Little by little, inch by inch, real jobs suck the humanity from you, enticing you to put self-sufficiency on the back burner by luring you deeper into their pockets with promises of bonuses, extra vacation days, and cute-sounding perks like casual Fridays. Distractions and tasks start to get the better of you, and complacency takes over. Before you realize it, you've begun meeting fewer people. Your drive dissipates. Your ambitions dwindle, and your passions take a back seat to getting things done. Suddenly, you've been transformed into a hollow shell of yourself, tricked into putting your plans on hold indefinitely, willing to deal with your misery in exchange for the comfort of a paycheck. You're stuck because now you feel like you really can't lose your real job. You're doomed because you don't know how to make it on your own, or you have nothing to fall back on. The broken promise. Face it, the work hard, get good grades, and go to college to get a good job philosophy is obsolete and completely irrelevant to our generation. Times have changed. Our mentors wanted us to apply their lessons to the world as they experienced it. They simply assumed that their way of life would continue. They didn't get the memo that they were disconnected, out of touch, and living in a new world where a one-person business armed with an email address and a mobile phone can rival captains of industry. Actually, it was probably emailed to them, and they forgot to call us to ask how to open the attachment. Today's job market is virtually non-existent because of explosive population growth, the overexpansion of educational institutions, and the effects of globalization. There were only a few million students enrolled in U.S. institutions when our parents went to college. There are more than 19 million today, not to mention millions more taking classes part-time or online. Similarly, our parents weren't competing for jobs in a global marketplace when they graduated. Like our grandparents, they mostly worked jobs within their local communities, in a time before the internet, when local consumption was high and the country still produced its own products. Today, many of us don't graduate from college to seek out local employment. Instead, we compete globally for jobs as assistants to assistants who recycle data and produce nothing of real, tangible value. Bottom line, we were promised more and expected more as a result. By the time we discovered our dream jobs were imaginary, it was too late. we ended up being forced into an assembly line system known as the real job. There were countless people you encountered along the way who could have explained the ways of the real world to you. But instead, everyone consciously decided to shield you from its harsh realities and fill your head with innumerable motivational sound bites. Your mother told you to work hard and you'll go far. Your high school valedictorian inspired you to pursue your dreams. MTV proclaimed, "You can do whatever you set your mind to." Do any of these catchphrases sound remotely applicable to the 9-to-5 lifestyle as we've come to know and experience it today? How many employed recent college grads do you know are living the dream? Most aren't even working in their fields of study, if they have jobs at all. I'm sure the individual with the $100,000 degree in public relations is thrilled about his position as the resident coffee and copy grunt for an insurance broker. No one ever said, "Work hard so that you get better placement in the system." Why? Because no one actually wanted you to become a corporate slave. They wanted you to fulfill their delusional expectations. And when their concepts of your dream job didn't materialize out of nowhere, you were told that you needed to get a real job. Now you're expected to forget everything you've ever known because you need to pay the bills. But when you can't even get real jobs, or the ones we're accepting aren't even in our field, what does that say about the credibility of the system? Contrary to what you may have been told, avoiding climbing the corporate ladder does not mean you are doomed to fail in life. You define your success in this world, not your parents, mentors, or teachers. They have, or eventually will, let their fears for your security, livelihood, and well-being overshadow the core values they instilled in you. Their values are still right, but their applications of those ideals are outdated, flawed, and no longer apply to your reality. If you're one of the tens of millions of young people who can't even get their footing on the corporate ladder, let alone climb it, then now isn't the time to actively keep putting your future in someone else's hands by continuing to mail out resumes. Such an action is the equivalent of inserting a quarter into a broken arcade game, losing it in the machine, and popping another quarter in, hoping for a different outcome. This is not a job market. It is an opportunity market. Stop trying to fight your way into the system, and fight your way around it instead. If you're wasting away at a 9-to-5 job, stop hurting yourself and your future. Paychecks come and go, but wasted time is gone forever. Rather than wasting time, money, and resources on sending out resumes or working dead-end real jobs to make ends meet, it's time to refocus your energies on attaining and securing your financial independence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.